consists of 12 cassettes, 12 hours of faith power. This is side one of cassette number 4. Message number 15, The Prayer of Faith. Here is Dr. Osborne.
James says, "The prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up." This promise was made to any who are sick. I thrill every time I think of the two all-inclusive words that march hand in hand across the pages of scriptural truth. They are the whosoever of salvation and the any of divine healing. If either of these words do not include you or anyone else, then I don't understand the English language. On the other hand, if the word any does include you and everyone else, then we should rejoice that healing is for all. The prayer of faith can never be offered while you're wondering whether or not God is willing to do the thing which you're asking him to do. Real faith comes by hearing the word of God. That is, by hearing God say through his word what he wants to do. Praying the prayer of faith is merely asking God to do the thing which he promised to do. If it's God's will for you to be sick, we could not pray the prayer of faith. If it's God's will for you to be sick, then it's wrong to ask someone to pray for your healing, for you should not want to thwart your heavenly Father's will. Neither should you seek help from doctors, nurses, or any other kind of medical aid, for in so doing, you would be saying in effect, "It's your will, Lord, that I should be ill, but I'm going to call a doctor or do some other thing so that I can avoid your will." To be perfectly logical, if you think it may not be God's will for you to be healed, you should make no effort whatsoever to get well, but should resign yourself to your fate and tell the world that you're suffering sickness for the sake of the Lord Jesus Christ. But when did he ever say that he wanted you to suffer sickness for him? Instead, he suffered sickness for you. If you really think it may be God's will for you to be sick, and you doubt his willingness to heal you, then I would suggest that you settle down and be content with your lot. If you believe that it's God's will for you to suffer, then I would suggest that you use your drug and doctor money for the good of others. For instance, it could be used to help spread the gospel. If God is not willing to heal you, and you want his will more than anything else in the world, I should not think it advisable to trust your case into the hands of a physician who would immediately seek to break God's will for you.
The prayer of faith.
Concerning the prayer of faith, many people have the idea that this always means an immediate answer. They think that unless instant results are manifested, the prayer of faith has not yet been offered. No doubt many have failed to receive our Lord's healing in their bodies because they've dictated to him just how and when they wanted to be blessed. Praying the prayer of faith does not necessarily mean that the answer is seen or felt immediately. It's the prayer offered by one who knows what God's word declares, is positive that God has heard that prayer, and knows that God is bound by his own covenant to answer and manifest the results asked for. God may do this instantly, or he may do it gradually, but one thing is certain, God will answer the prayer of faith. Once the prayer of faith is offered and the disease is rebuked, the case is in the hands of the Lord, and he does the restoring. Whether it's done instantly or by a gradual healing from that time, that doesn't matter. His word stands true, and it's for us to believe and doubt not, trusting him to completely and thoroughly sweep away the disease.
Faith versus symptoms.
When you fully complied with the word of God and offered the prayer of faith, you can from that very moment declare yourself healed by the power of God, because his word says in 1 John 5:15, "If we know that he hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him." Although in some cases the symptoms of a disease may linger for a while, faith declares it done because God's word says so. Faith is not afraid to take its stand upon the Word of God. Faith has nothing to do with anything but the Word of God. The tempter whispers, "You dare not claim your healing. You're not healed. Just look at those symptoms." But the true believer rests secure in the promises of the Word, believing, trusting, giving God the glory, realizing that God is true to His Word and that Satan is not only a liar, but the father of lies.
Faith in the Word of God.
If you have faith, Jesus said in Matthew 17:20, "Nothing shall be impossible to you." He said in John 15:7, "If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you." He also said in John 14:14, "If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it." Again in Mark 11:24, "What things soever ye desire, when ye pray for them, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them." This is why you can pray the prayer of faith and leave the results with God regardless of circumstances. I could prove this to you by hundreds of incidents that have taken place in our gospel crusades across the United States and around the world. But if I only related these experiences to you, your faith might stand in what happened to other people instead of on what the Word of God says. I have included in this living audio book a remarkable report of miracles which have taken place in our mass crusades around the world. These are included to prove that Jesus Christ is the same today for anyone who believes His Word. But relating experiences only, while it might encourage your faith, only hearing the Word of God really creates faith.
Faith and our five senses.
God's Word alone creates faith. If we only related experiences, we would appeal to the natural senses. Your senses have nothing to do with faith, and true faith must ignore your senses. If you walk by faith, you cannot walk by sight. If you are to consider the Word of God as true, then you cannot always consider the evidence of your senses as true. If you are to believe the Word of God, then you must often ignore your senses. Feeling, smelling, tasting, hearing, seeing are the senses with which the natural person has to do. The Word of God and faith are the two factors with which the spiritual person has to do. According to 2 Corinthians 5:7, the natural person walks by the senses, but the spiritual person walks by faith in the Word of God. Sight and feeling belong to the natural person. Faith belongs to the supernatural person. Every Christian is a supernatural person. It seems unreasonable to some people not to believe the natural senses. They have accepted them as conclusive evidence for so long that it's difficult for them to realize that there is other evidence besides that of the five natural senses. People have been taught that the final court of appeal is the natural senses. Seeing is believing, they say. They've based their lives on that premise and have failed to take into account the higher source of knowledge. This higher knowledge is revelation faith, which comes through the Word of God and through prayer. The Word of God should be the final court of appeal for the Christian, the super person. Often, when Christians are told that they are to walk by faith and not by sight, and to disregard sense evidence, they think this is unreasonable. "Do you mean to say," they ask, "that I can't depend on what I see? I could never accept such an absurdity. When I hold a book in my hand, I see it and feel it, and I can smell the printer's ink on its pages. If I drop it, I can hear it fall. Do you mean to tell me that the book is not real and that it's not here?" No, we don't mean that. We may accept the evidence of our senses as true in natural things. But in spiritual things, when this evidence contradicts God's Word, then we ignore our senses and believe what the Word of God says.
What witnesses to our healing? the hot flash, the cold chill, or the word.
I've often wondered why someone who thinks it absurd to believe that God's word is true, even when their senses testify to the contrary, have such faith in a contagious disease to which their child has been exposed. They believe that their child will begin coughing in a certain number of days because it played with Johnny, who's now in bed with whooping cough. They have no physical evidence that their child will have this disease. They are expecting it purely by faith. Faith in Satan's whooping cough. Without feeling it, they just believe it. They have faith in it. When their child was exposed, it didn't get a hot flash, which was the witness or sign that the exposure had been made, nor did it get a shock to prove it. The child has no apparent symptoms of the disease. It's as well as ever, but they know it will have the whooping cough in a few days. How do they know? They have what we call faith in the disease. They believe the disease has begun its work in spite of the fact that they cannot see, feel, smell, taste, or hear anything of it with their senses. That's what we call faith. The only fault here is that this is faith in the wrong thing, but it certainly is faith. They trust the devil so completely and believe so fully in his diseases, yet they feel we are being unreasonable when we lay hands on them and tell them, your sickness will leave, it must go, because God has said it will go. He said, you shall recover, so nothing can stop it. Many say, seeing is believing. But according to the word of God, believing is seeing. Others say, I'll never believe it until I see it. I reply, you'll never see it until you believe it. As soon as you believe it, God delights to let you see it, since faith is the substance or evidence of things not seen. Faith brings the unseen things into being and makes the unfelt things real to the senses. It pleases God when you look only at his word. It pleases him when you base your faith on his promise. By this kind of faith, Hebrews 11:2 says, the elders obtained a good report from him, and so will you. Faith in his word is always pleasing to the Father. When Jesus was here in the flesh, he recognized the evidence of the senses, but he never allowed himself to be dominated by them. The senses were his servants. He lived above them. He pronounced the blind man healed and the leper cleansed when apparently they were still blind and still leprous. He called the things that were not as though they were, and they came to pass. Jesus cursed a fig tree one day, and its roots died. But its death was not evidenced until the next day, when it was seen to have died from the roots. Not from the visible branches down, but from the invisible roots up, according to Mark 11:20. Our senses relate to the natural person in the natural world. But in obtaining blessings from the spiritual world, faith relates to the spiritual person. We may accept the evidence of our senses as long as it does not contradict the word of God. However, when the word differs from our senses, we are to ignore the evidence of our senses and act on the word. When we do this, the Father honors his word and makes it good in our lives. We're always safe when we believe God, no matter how convincing the evidence of our senses may be. What God says is always true. Romans 3:4 says, let God be true, but every man a liar. Sense knowledge is a lie when it does not agree with the word of God. When we're walking by faith, we delight to cast aside the senses and enjoy the Father's already provided blessings.
Abraham's faith.
The greatest lesson one could ever study on this subject is that of Abraham's faith. Of Abraham, Romans 4:18-21 says, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, not grumbling and complaining because the answer was not manifested immediately, but giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. Isn't that wonderful? Abraham completely ignored the evidences of his physical senses, which testified to the fact that he was almost 100 years old, far too old to become the father of children. Sarah felt old, looked old, and was old, according to the natural senses. But Abraham ignored that too. Why did he ignore these facts? Because they contradicted what God had said. God said Abraham would have a son. His physical senses said impossible. But he ignored his physical senses and believed the word of God. That is faith. Romans 4:3. What saith the scripture? Abraham believed God. The word believe is a verb, and a verb shows action. I would say Abraham acted like what God said would come to pass.
Sarah's faith.
Sarah did not feel like she had the strength to conceive seed and to be delivered of a child, but she ignored her feelings, and through faith also, Hebrews 11:11 says, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age. How did this come about to a woman who was nearly 100 years old? It was not by the evidence of her senses, not by her feeling, but according to Hebrews 11:11, because she judged God faithful who had promised.
Faith and the natural man.
Faith does not care about what the natural eye can see, what the natural ear can hear, or what the physical body can feel. Faith sees only God's word of promise. The natural eyes see only the great walls of Jericho. The natural ears hear only the taunting of the enemy. But faith sees the walls fallen and the enemy conquered. The natural body feels the gnawing pains of the cancer. But faith sees it dried up and consumed by the healing power of Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that healeth thee, according to Exodus 15:26. The natural eye sees the blackness of the clouds hanging low overhead. The natural ears hear the blast of the thunder. But faith quietly commands, "Peace, be still." The natural eye sees the flesh consumed by tuberculosis. The physical hand feels the fever burning away the tissues of the body. But faith sees consumption as a part of the curse of the law, according to Deuteronomy 28:22. Faith sees it cursed at Calvary, where its victim was redeemed, according to Galatians 3:13. In the name of Jesus, faith commands the disease to come out of its victim, then leaves the room with quiet assurance that what the Bible says shall come to pass. They shall recover. The Lord shall raise them up.
Faith versus reason.
One would almost think that faith is blind to physical conditions. When reason argues with it, faith just smiles unwaveringly. Faith sees Satan defeated, even when he is seen ruling in power. In the mind of faith, diseases are healed even before a prayer is offered. Faith moves and acts as God moves and acts. Reason is troubled, excited, nervous, but faith stands unmoved. Faith knows that God cannot lie, so faith never argues, but takes it for granted when a request has been made according to the word of God. Faith reckons the work as finished, even before it's manifested.
Faith and the word are victors.
Read God's word. Feed on God's Word. Live in God's Word. Let it produce faith in your heart. David said in Psalms 119, verse 130, "The entrance of thy words giveth light. It giveth understanding to the simple." Know the integrity of God's Word and step out on that Word. It will not fail you because God will not fail you. David also said in Psalms 119, verse 11, "Thy word have I hid in mine heart, that I might not sin against thee." Charles H. Spurgeon said, "This is a good thing, in a good place, for a good purpose," end quote. We may change this scripture a little and use it in reference to sickness. "Thy word have I hid in mine heart, that I might be kept from sickness by thee." And it'll still be what Spurgeon said it is, a good thing in a good place for a good purpose. Because Romans 10:17 says, "Faith cometh by hearing," or by knowing, "the word of God." And healing comes through faith in the promises of God. Real faith in God and in His word is never discouraged. Real faith always thrives on a test. Faith lives in the light of anticipated results. It does not look at or live in bondage to present circumstances, but rather it overrules circumstances and determines destiny by walking in the light of promised accomplishments. Persistent faith always wins. Let nothing discourage you. Let nothing change you. Allow no symptoms to change your attitude toward God's Word. Settle it forever in your heart that God's promises will be fulfilled. It may require 7 trips around the walls of Jericho, as recorded in Joshua chapter 6, or 7 dips in the River Jordan, as recorded in 2 Kings chapter 5, but the victory will come through persistent faith in what God has said. Faith is the victor. Faith comes by hearing God's word. So read His word and enjoy a life of victorious faith.
Faith is a possessor.
God said to Joshua, "Every place where your foot shall tread, I have given it to you for an inheritance," was the inspiring promise which greeted the Israelites as they faced the promised land. Footprints meant possession, but it must be their own footprints. In possessing your New Testament blessings provided in redemption, every promise that you put your feet upon is yours. The rich plain of healing is yours to the extent that you tread upon it. The fertile valley of deliverance is yours if you'll go in and possess it. The upland of spiritual power is yours if you'll imitate grand old Caleb and by faith drive out the Anakims of unbelief that dwell there, according to Joshua chapter 14, verses 6 through 15. Any or all of these blessings are yours to possess in the mighty name of Jesus. All of the blessed promises of the Word of God are yours, so don't be slack to go up and possess your land. Between you and your possessions are powerful enemies, but gather your forces in prayer and faith in that all-sufficient name and go against them. Don't give up until the last enemy is conquered. The size of your inheritance depends on how much land you've stood on, walked on, and really claimed. If you've not claimed it all, then as much more of it is yours as you dare to possess. According to Ephesians 6, verses 10 to 17, put on the whole armor of God, which will make you invulnerable. Take the sword of the Spirit, which will make you invincible. Fight the good fight of faith, according to 1 Timothy 6:12. Endure hardness as a good soldier, according to 2 Timothy 2:3. Resist the devil, and you'll find the promise is true. He will flee from you, according to James 4 and 7. To most people, faith is merely a word or a theory. You can make it a fact and a power. Satan knows that in the matter of healing, God's interests and yours are identical. He knows that God and you are allies. He knows that God cannot let you fail while you're trusting His Word, for He could not do that without seeing Himself fail, and this He cannot do. 1 Corinthians 16:13, when the prayer of faith has been prayed, stand fast in the faith. Quit you like men. Be strong. Don't give up. Reckon on a well body. Take for granted that you will recover. Lay claim to your covenant rights. Then God will get the glory, and you will get the victory. Faith is the victory, according to 1 John 5:4. You may ask, Mr. Osborne, do you believe that I must have faith? Don't you think I could be healed through your faith? Well, the Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it's impossible to please God. And in 2 Corinthians 5:7, we walk by faith and not by sight. There's no doubt but that being healed through another's faith is the scriptural exception, not the rule. I would advise you to abide by the rule rather than by the exception. I'm certain that when you've heard the Word of God, until faith has been born in your heart, and the Word, if given heed to, will always produce faith, you will be healed through your own faith. The Father planned that every believer should be a conqueror, not just a few who are favored. God wants you to discover that you have power over the devil. He wants you to know that you have power over sickness, that you are a victor, that you are a conqueror, that you can rebuke disease and sickness and see the symptoms melt away. You'll never be able to walk in this victory as long as you're depending on the faith of someone else. Neither can the faith of another person set you free from sin. You must hear the gospel and be convicted of your sins. You must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as your own Savior. Then you are saved. You must hear the Word of God. You must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as your healer. Then by His stripes, you are healed. In most cases, Jesus didn't heal anyone until after He had obtained that person's confession of faith, or until He'd observed some act of faith for healing. This was so in the case of the centurion in Matthew chapter 8. The Bible says of the palsied man who was let down through the roof on a cot, and Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the sick of the palsy, arise, and take up thy bed, and go thy way. That's in Matthew chapter 9, verse 2, and Mark chapter 2, verse 11. If you were bedfast, you would not allow four men to carry you onto a roof and then let you down, cot and all, through a hole in the roof, unless you believed that something would happen to you when you were placed before the Lord. Faith is more often seen than heard. Jesus saw their faith in their actions. James 2:26 says, faith without works or actions that correspond is dead. In the case of the two blind men who followed Jesus crying, thou son of David, have mercy on us. Jesus said to them, believe ye that I am able to do this? They said unto him, yea, Lord. Then touched he their eyes, saying, according to your faith, be it done unto you. And their eyes were opened. That's in Matthew chapter 9, verses 27 to 30. To the woman of Canaan, who sought mercy from the Lord for her daughter, who was lying at home grievously vexed with a devil, Jesus replied, after he had seen her persistent and unwavering faith, O woman, great is thy faith, be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. Matthew chapter 15, verse 28. To the woman who had an issue of blood for 12 years and who pressed through the crowd, saying within herself, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. Jesus said, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Mark chapter 5, verse 28 and 34. To the blind man in Mark chapter 10, Jesus said, go thy way. Thy faith hath made thee whole. Verse 52. To the one leper who returned to give praise, Jesus said, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. Luke 17:19. When a certain man asked Jesus to come to his house and heal his son because he was at the point of death, Jesus said, go thy way, thy son liveth. And the Bible says, the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. And while he was on his way home, his servants met him and told him, saying, "Thy son liveth." That's in John chapter 4, verse 47 to 53. There are many cases in the Gospels that do not state whether or not the people who were healed had faith, such as the woman bowed over with an infirmity in Luke chapter 13, the man with a withered hand in Matthew chapter 12, the man at the pool of Bethesda in John chapter 5, the multitudes in Matthew chapter 12, verse 15, chapter 14, verse 14, chapter 14, verse 35, 36, Mark 6, verse 56, and there are many others. But it's certain that they had faith to be healed, because when Mark says, "And Jesus could do no mighty works, save that he laid his hands upon a few sick folks and healed them," his inability to do mighty works there was laid to their unbelief. Mark 6, verses 1 to 6. When Paul was preaching the gospel at Lystra, one of his hearers was a man whose feet were crippled. He had been born in this condition. No doubt Paul desired that the man be healed immediately. Instead, Paul waited until the lame man had heard the word of God and had obtained faith for healing. Then Paul, steadfastly beholding him and perceiving that he had faith to be healed, said with a loud voice, "Stand upright on thy feet." And he leaped and walked. That's in Acts chapter 14, verses 8 to 10. During our gospel crusades around the world, I've seen tens of thousands of sufferers of disease and sickness completely healed while in the audience listening to the message we were preaching. The preaching of the word always produces faith when given heed to. The Bible says in Hebrews 11 and 2, "By faith the elders obtained a good report." God was pleased with the patriarchs of old when they manifested great faith. Hebrews 11 and 6 says, "Without faith, it's impossible to please God." Do not depend on the faith of someone else. Have your own faith. You'll always keep that with you, because God is always with you, and so is His Word.
Individual faith.
God's promises are for you personally. You have an individual right to pray for and receive ever-blessing promise to the believer. Jesus said, "Everyone that asketh, receiveth." He emphasizes that fact 6 times so that you will clearly understand that He wants you to feel free to ask Him what you want. He says, "Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened to you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth. He that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be open." 6 times that was repeated in Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 and 8. All through the Bible, God seeks to impress every one of His children that we all have equal rights. He respects none above others. He has no favorites. He expects each one of us to have faith. John 6, 37, Jesus says, "Him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out." That includes you. Christ is saying, "Him that cometh to me for any need, whatever it may be, I will not refuse him." Jesus said in John 15, 7, "If ye abide in me, my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you." Mark 11, 24, Jesus said, "What things soever ye desire when ye pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them." Paul said in Romans 10, 9, "If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved." To be saved, you must do your own repenting, your own believing, your own confessing, your own accepting, your own receiving. Then you will be saved. To be healed, you have the right to do your own asking, your own believing, your own claiming, your own receiving. Then you will be healed. Thousands of Christians are spending their lives asking others to pray for them, depending on the prayers and the faith of other people, as though others were closer to God than they, as though others could pray better than they, as though God will hear the prayer of others quicker than their own prayers. Every Christian has equal rights, and it's God's will and desire that each of his children claim and accept all of his blessings. Every person can pray and receive the answer. Jesus said, "Everyone that asketh, receiveth." Every sinner who's ever been saved had to prove Christ's statement to be true, otherwise he or she could never have been saved. If the privilege, "Everyone that asketh," is available to the unconverted, how much more is it available to God's children? That is, if this privilege was available before we were saved, how much more is it available after we're saved? Every child can do its own asking from its parents. Every baby does its own asking, even before it can speak a word. Unable to do anything but cry, it does its own asking. Certainly the other children in the family don't have to beg the mother to please nurse the baby. The baby asks for itself. There are thousands of Christians who've never learned the privilege of asking for themselves. They spend their time writing or calling on others to pray for them, to do their praying for them, to ask God for them. Others may pray with you, but never substitute the prayers of others for your own asking, because Jesus said, "Everyone that asketh, receiveth." Everyone who has a bank account can use it personally. How unreasonable it would be for me to ask someone across town to go to the bank and try to get some of my money out of my account. It's my account. I can draw my own check without any trouble. I have a right to demand the money because it's mine. Every blessing which Christ died to provide is the private property of every person for whom he died. The Bible tells us that every snake-bitten Israelite, when he looked on the brazen serpent, lived, according to Numbers chapter 21, verses 8 and 9. Every one of them had to do their own looking at the brazen serpent. In Psalms 107:19, the people were nigh unto death, but when they cried unto the Lord, he sent his word and healed them. Tens of thousands of times in our campaigns, people have been healed of all manner of sicknesses, diseases, and infirmities while they were in the audience, healed through their own faith, which they had received through hearing the word of God. Faith is believing that God will do what he said in his word that he'll do. God has never asked anyone to believe him for anything that he didn't first promise to do. God has said, "I am the Lord that healeth thee." The prophet Isaiah said, "He," Jesus, "was wounded for our transgressions. With his stripes we are healed." Jesus said to the leper in Matthew 8, verse 3, "I will, be thou clean." He said to the centurion in Matthew chapter 8, verse 7, "I will come and heal your servant." To the blind man, Jesus said in Luke 18:42, "Receive thy sight." Peter said in 1 Peter 2:24, "Who his own self bare our sins, by whose stripes ye were healed." Jesus said in Mark 16, verses 17, 18, "They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover, and in my name shall they cast out devils." James said in James chapter 5, "Is any sick among you? The prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up." Faith is merely believing that God will do these and other things which he said in his word that he'd do if we would only believe them. Mark 9:23, "If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him or her that believeth."
Have faith in God.
We could sum up the matter by quoting the command of Jesus in Mark 11:22, "Have faith in God." Faith will always move the hand of God. Faith always possesses. Faith is a persistent force. Faith relies on the ability of God. Faith knows no defeat. Faith thrives on a test. Faith never argues. Faith never gets excited. Faith never brags on itself. Faith is never nervous. Faith never trembles. Faith is never overpowered. Faith looks directly to the Word of God. Faith knows what God has said because it's been begotten by the Word of God. Faith knows that what God said is a revelation of what He wills to do. Faith accepts God's Word as final. Faith claims the Word and steps out on it. Faith possesses the promises. Faith demands results. Faith claims its covenant rights. When reason argues, when one fears, trembles, and becomes nervous, faith stands steadfast and unmovable because it knows what God has said. That settles the matter with faith. Faith is invincible. Faith is irresistible. Be grounded in the Word of God. Know His Word. That way you know His will. Bring your request to Him and leave the results with Him. Give Him a chance to do for you what He's been wanting so long to do, but could not do until you were ready to act on His Word in faith. Do as Abraham did. He believed God, and according to Romans 4, verses 19-21, being not weak in faith, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, being fully persuaded that what God had promised, he was able also to perform. Right now, go to God and quote any of His promises that you want Him to fulfill for you. Ask Him to do it. Pray the prayer of faith for that promise. That is, place your order in the letter drop of faith and turn it loose. Trust it to the heavenly authorities to take it through and to bring you the order properly filled. Don't keep praying again and again for the thing desired. Turn your faith loose for that thing. And let faith bring you the answer. Maintain this attitude of faith. Refuse to be moved. Let nothing budge you from your stand on the promise of God. And your prayer will be answered to the fullest extent. For God will say to you, as Jesus said in Matthew 8:13, go thy way, and as thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee.
Message number 17, the importance of confession.
You said that you could not do it, and the moment you said it, you were whipped. You said you did not have faith, and at that moment, doubt arose like a giant and bound you. Perhaps you never realized that to a great extent, you are ruled by your words. You talked failure, and failure held you in bondage. You talked fear, and fear increased its grip on you. Solomon said in Proverbs 6:2, thou art snared with the words of thy mouth. Thou art taken captive with the words of thy mouth.
Testifying, witnessing, confessing.
Few Christians have recognized the importance of confession and the place it holds in their lives. Whenever the word confession is used, they automatically think of confessing sin or weakness or failure. But this is only the negative side of the subject. The negative confession of your sin was only to open the way to the positive confession of all of God's Word. Nothing in your walk as a believer is more important than your confession, though it's hardly ever mentioned in traditional theology. Christianity is called the confession. According to Hebrews chapter 3, the Greek word, which has been translated profession in the King James Version, is rendered confession in other cases. And the word profession in Hebrews 3:1 is confession or acknowledgement in the original. The two words are closely related, yet the difference is important. The Greek word from which the word confession is translated actually means saying the same thing. It means saying what God says. It means to agree with God in your testimony, saying what God says in His Word about your sins, about your sicknesses, your apparent failures, your health, your salvation, your victories, or about anything else in your life. In other words, testify to or acknowledge what God says.
Confession in trial.
For example, sickness is pressing to overthrow your health. Symptoms of some disease are beginning to appear. Satan is desiring to destroy your health and to render your life ineffective in Christian service. But God has made provision for your health. He's made a covenant of healing with you. He's promised, according to Exodus 23, verse 25, "Ye shall serve the Lord your God, and he will take sickness away from the midst of thee." And he promised in Exodus 15, 26, "I am the Lord that healeth thee." God's word says in Psalms 103, verse 3, "He healeth all thy diseases." Jesus Christ has redeemed you from the fall of humanity, from your diseases, because himself took our infirmities and bare our diseases, Matthew 8, 17. He bore them at the cruel whipping post, according to Mark 15, verses 16 to 20, Matthew 27, verse 26, and John 19, verse 1. And therefore, according to 1 Peter 2, 24, "By his stripes ye were healed." Knowing all of this provides a basis for your faith. You know that Satan cannot lay a disease on your body because Christ has already borne your diseases for you in your place. Therefore, you resist Satan and his lying symptoms of disease. You do not fear them. You know that your redemption is a fact. You know that your diseases were laid on the body of Christ and that he has borne them for you. You have no fear. You boldly and firmly rebuke Satan, your adversary, with the word of God in the name of Jesus, who died to set you free. You take your firm stand. You do exactly as Christ, your example, did when he was tempted by Satan in the wilderness. You say, "Satan, it is written." Then you quote him the Bible. "By his stripes I am healed. He healeth all my diseases. Christ himself took my infirmities and bore my sicknesses." This is confession. Confession is saying what God says, talking the language of the Bible at all times. It's resisting Satan with, "Thus saith the Lord." It's claiming your rights at the throne of grace, confessing God's word, God's promises. The Greek word from which confession is translated actually means saying the same thing, that is, saying what God says, or agreeing with God in your conversation, acknowledging the word. A friend comes to you during your trial of faith and suggests, "Oh, you must be careful. I know a person who died of this sickness. You must go quickly to bed and call for help." But you speak God's language because you believe what God says. You use his words in your lips. In your conversation, you boldly confess, "The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Christ hath borne my diseases, and by his stripes I am healed." Under all circumstances, at all times, you speak God's language. You harmonize your language and your thoughts with his. His attitude, as set forth in his word, is developed into your life until Satan cannot prevail against you, because God's word has become molded into your very life and nature, according to 2 Peter 1 and 4. You become as irresistible as God is, because of God's word that comes to control your prayers, your words, your thoughts, your actions. Confession is affirming something that you believe. It's testifying to something that you know. It's witnessing of a truth which you embrace. God's word is the exclusive subject of your confession, of your testimony. Jesus planned that this great message of Christianity should be given to the world through testimony, that is, through the confession of those who believe in it. The great leaders and agencies of the new and revolutionizing life of Jesus Christ, which is Christianity, have been testifiers, witnesses, and confessors. The major problem that we face then is to know what we are to confess. And the answer is simply God's Word, at all times, in the face of all adversities, under all circumstances. Confession is affirming Bible truths. Confession is repeating with our lips, from our hearts, the things God has said in His Word.